today. If not, just leave a comment in the chat. But we're glad that you've joined us, and we're happy to have you all as subscribers too, and we may have some of you that are interested in subscribing to the newsletter. And this is what, you know, we're talking about. For those of you that may be new, this is our printed version of Content Solutions. And what we're going to do today is just give you a little bit of background about the newsletter, and then Steven is going to share his marketing tips, and then Jen's going to be sharing some information with you about how you can print your newsletters. So just a little bit of background with us, with the newsletter, is we actually started this in 2008. It was a brainstorm of Steven that the industry needed something very specific for content marketing. So we started it in 2008, and we're really proud of it. We've made some improvements with the graphics, and we created a territory-based marketing tool. So, you know, for your territories, you're the only ones that are mailing into those territories. And we've sold hundreds through the years, and, you know, we're really, you know, proud of it. So, Steven, just so you understand his role, he is obviously a co-founder. He is our writer, and you've probably talked to him or Jen with a sale. Myself, I help edit the newsletter after Steven does his initial writing, and then I help with the distribution. Jen, you've probably talked to her. She's with sales, and she is a territory manager. So if you ever have any questions about the territory, she's the one to speak with. And she handles all the payments, and you know, any questions that you have, always start out with Jen. So we are proud that, I call it my big little secret. Steven said it wasn't really necessary to reveal that he is my ghostwriter, and I've been published in several magazines, and I'm proud to have Steven as my ghostwriter. We did win the Golden Quill Award in 2015 for an article that he helped me write. And so, you know, it's nice to know that our writer has won an award within the industry. So I'm happy to be working along with Steven. Steven, can you see the screen now?
Yes, I can see it.
Okay. So I'm going to turn everything back over to Steven, and he's going to take it from here. Thanks.
Okay. Now, just so you folks know, part of the technical glitch we were talking about has to do with my PowerPoint. The ladies have access to it, though, and they may have to pull the slides forward one at a time, and thus will there'll be some banter between us. That's the only hope we have at this point, to make sure that all of the slides get shared with you. Can you see my I see there's an arrow going across the screen, but it's not mine, is it?
Oh, it's mine. Sorry about that.
That's quite all right. All right. I had some ideas with laser pointers and things I was going to use, but I'm going to think that's not going to work on this particular technology. Anyway, all this that Barb has written for you already is all good information. There's one thing she didn't add, and that is that Jennifer Hahn is our technical lady, and she's going to give a little speech in a few minutes here. But when she does, she's going to go through it. I'm a baby boomer, and she claims not to be a millennial, but when she speaks, millennials understand her and boomers don't. So what I'm going to suggest is that she also will give you a 30-minute consultation on all of the material she's going to share with you. Okay, let's have a look at the next slide. Okay. There was a fella not long ago who wrote to us and said, nobody's reading my newsletter, Content Solutions. I hand it to him and they just throw it away. And I was going to ask him how he knew that, because I don't think they're doing it in his presence. But I said, look, you tell me there's somebody out there who's saying, so what if there's a company that can save me megabucks on virtually every job? So what if there's no other contracts I've ever offered me or told me that they can do the same things? And I listed all these things, and he got real quiet at that point. But the bottom line is, you are doing something extraordinary for the agents and adjusters. Anyone who gets this has a real advantage. But there's a problem, and the problem is they don't trust you. They don't trust him, that's for sure. But they don't—they're not trusting us as an entity in the industry. I ran across an article. Let me see if I can find. Here we go. I ran across an article a couple of months ago in Restoration and Remediation magazine, and the title caught my interest immediately. It says, "What do adjusters really think of contents restoration?" Mike O'Donnell was the author of the article, and he says he spent an afternoon reaching out to adjusters to see how they really feel about contents restoration. Here's what they said, and I quote, contents restoration, snake in the grass. Another one, unnecessary evil. Another one, inexperienced contents companies cause more trouble than they are worth. Well, we'd agree to that, because your people are trained. That helps the adjusters and the agents, makes them look good to their customers. But the one that was a showstopper for me was 30% overcharge across the board. That's what they think of contents restoration professionals. 30% overcharge across the board. It's hard to steal a happy client. It's easy to steal one who doesn't trust you. And right now, these guys are saying, we don't trust you. We got to fix that. So the next slide will show you how we're going to begin that. Thank you. First, we go to the agents. We say, oh, by the way, go to the agents and adjusters who like you. These next technologies I'm going to share with you only work if you start off with somebody who already knows you, trusts you, like you, somebody you've worked with already and said you did a good job and I want to work with you in the future, something like that. So you go to Charlie and say, Charlie, I need a stack. This is an agent. Agent Charlie, I need a stack of your business cards. And he says, what do you want my business cards for? Get your own. You say, no. Look, I'm in the past. First of all, I should tell you, I'm going to get your policies renewed this year. I'm going to make you look real good on paper and real good on your bottom line. And the way I'm going to do it is I used to go to people's doors, knock on them. This is a homeowner. We're going to do the job for them. We knock on the door, take a step back, introduce my staff. Hi, this is Bob. He just got back from Afghanistan 6 months ago, and now he's working for us. He's going to be our logistics guy. He's going to move your stuff from here over to our cleaning facility and back again safely. He's good at that sort of thing. You can count on him. And this is Jane. Jane's our DPI expert, the digital photo inventory. She's going to take a lot of pictures, and she's going to share them with you, and she's going to share them with the adjuster so that we're all on the same page, and you'll know where your stuff is, and he will know how to create a very good estimate for your belongings. And you say that, but then I would have a little basket. I'd give him a present of some kind, maybe a basket with assorted nuts, caramelized popcorn, candy, something, comfort foods. And I'd say, this is from our company. Inside you'll find a little sheet there that is for a testimonial, should you decide to give us one. I guess we're switching slides here. They were still in the same one. I'm still talking to the agents. Anyway, bottom line is I used to give them the basket with all kinds of our stuff in it, our contact information, a testimonial form, our company colors, telephone numbers, all that sort of thing. But this time, I'm going to take all that stuff out, and the only thing they're going to see in the basket of literature is your card. We'll still have the popcorn, still have the nuts, flowers, candy, whatever we decide goes in the basket. But the only thing left that's going to be of any readable value is your business card. And on the back, there's going to be a little message. It'll say something like, because I care, or don't worry, I'm only a phone call away. Something that shows you care about this case and that you're actually paying attention to what's going on with them. And then at the end of the job, Charlie, I'm going to sit down with the client. I'll walk them through the house first. I'll say, well, what do you think of this room? Do we do a good job on this piece of furniture? And they'll say, yeah, we love this. I want to give you a testimonial. We'll get your testimonial. That's outstanding. And then as we're exiting the door, usually the contents people are the last ones there. We vacuum up, clean up a little bit. But as we're exiting the house, I turn back to them and say, by the way, your agent, Joe, sent another gift. And she opens it up and looks at it, and there's a card. And the card says, glad we got through this one. I'm still here when you need me. Something like that. And what that does is give her the impression that you first of all cared about the case, but that you were there from the beginning to the end of the case. And if you really, really, really want to go over the top on this, you'd say, Charlie, after we've done the business card technology, I'm going to be in the house with her. And at one point, I'm going to bring out a laptop. And just like we're doing right now on the video screen. I'm going to set you up with about a 2-minute phone call with her. We might use Skype or something like that. But anyway, at a certain hour, you choose the hour, you choose a day, Wednesday at 3 o'clock, something like that. We put her on the screen with you, and you turn to her and say, "Hi, I'm your agent, Joe. I'm working with you. I just wanted you to know that I'm still watching over the case, and you can always contact me anytime you need me," something of that nature, something really simple. And by the way, there's another one. We're going to be looking for opportunities to bring you in so you can talk to the customer on a very personal and an exciting level. Like a case that Barb had, there was a little old lady, grandma, in the house, and grandma's photos got wet during the disaster. They started sticking together, and they were kind of tearing. The paper was disintegrating. Well, Barb had one of her crew scan them into a computer, and they gave them at the end a little disc with all the photos on it. She put them on a computer screen, which blew them up, of course, and they maintained their integrity because it's all digital. So she's looking at him. She's saying, "You know, I didn't know Harriet had blue eyes," and that was a golden moment to have the agent walk in. You say, "Agent, I'm going to be looking for moments like that." So instead of us giving them a disc, you show up and just for, you know, 5-minute interaction, you walk in for 5 minutes and say, "The contents people told me they were going to do this. I wanted to be here to enjoy it with you." You hand it to them, and suddenly you're the hero of the day. See, we don't need to have a lot of good feelings toward us. We always do get them because we do extraordinary things for them every time. But it wouldn't hurt your renewals for your policies to have these kind of things happening throughout the entire relationship. Okay, that's for agents. Let's take a look at what we do for the adjusters. Now, the adjusters, they're different. They don't care about business cards. They don't care about the accolades. That has no interest for them at all. But they'll tell you, if you say, "Adjuster, what do you really want from a contractor?" And the adjuster will say, "Well, I really want the job done fast. I want it done cheap." They'll almost always, that's their standard answer. And they're not kidding you. They actually mean it. But that's not what they really want. It's not a lie. What they're saying is, "That's my feeling about the case." And the reason they feel that way is because that's what their boss wants. By the way, you know that stuff about 30% overcharge I just read you from the article a minute ago? Tim Jackson and I were talking a couple of days ago. Tim's Barb's husband. And Tim said, "Look, just tell them to use Barb's technique under those circumstances. If they think we're overcharging them or something, if the agents and adjusters are thinking that we're padding our bill somehow, have them do what Barb does." And what does Barb do? Barb, if there's time, I'll have Barb tell you the whole story, but the highlights are Barb does what she calls a pre-estimate and before the job even gets underway. She hands that to the adjuster. The adjuster looks at it and says, "Oh, no, I'm not going to allow that. That's not the kind of thing we pay for. Over here, no, that X that one out. We're not going to do that." And Barb has a plan B. She says, "Okay, there was a fire in the house, and you're saying don't do the master bedroom because it wasn't involved in the fire. Well, okay, we can do a surface cleaning then. And we won't go into the drawers and under the beds and all that sort of thing. We won't do that kind of cleaning. We'll do a surface cleaning to get all the particulates that may have floated in." And the guy, usually he'll find a level at which he can agree. In other words, he decides what is going to be payable before the job even gets underway. Now, again, you have a 30-minute consultation with Barb. If you want to learn more about that, by all means, give her a call. But the bottom line of all this is their bottom line looks very good. And Barb gets paid. Why does she get paid? I mean, they don't string it out for a couple of years and talk to you about it and come back and push back and all that sort of thing. What they do is they pay her because they agreed at the very beginning. This is a legitimate estimate based on legitimate things that we will legitimately pay for. And thus, it's a very good interaction, very good relationship with them. But we're going to go a step farther. You know that Xactimate estimate that you do, the invoice, the slots you fill in and you fill out so that it tells them what you're going to charge and how you're going to charge it and why you're charging it, a little line item thing. You've all done them, and whether it's Xactimate or some other company, but you've all done these estimates. We're going to add a new page to the estimate, one that's not in any computer, one that's not created by any software system. Take a sheet of paper. And, you know, on every job, you guys are saving stuff for the adjuster, for the insurance company, for the homeowner. You save things. You restore things instead of having them cashed out, which saves them a fortune. Let's say there's a $5,000 African leather couch. And he's saying, "Well, that's waterlogged and looks like the edge there is scorched. I'm not sure. We'll have to probably just cash it out. And he's looking at, he doesn't want to do it, but he's looking at $5,000 worth of cash out. You come along and say, look, I know a guy that can restore this. My own team will get the thing started, but that scorch thing is real easy to fix. We've done it before. I think I can save this. And so you go in and restore it instead of having him replace it, give it back to him. He just saved $4,000. He paid $1,000 to the guy to do whatever the leather work is, and he saved $4,000. So here's what you do. On this sheet of paper, you put down one leather couch, African leather couch, $5,000. That's how much it's worth. We charged you $1,000 for it. You save $4,000. Little line item things like that. And by the way, it's not going to happen that way all the time. You know, that remember that Coco Chanel purse that the team restored a while back? It was a $5,000 Coco Chanel purse, and they restored it for $79.99. We'll come to that in a minute. But see, that's the kind of item that you put on. You can't do it for every item you saved, because you saved a lot of stuff. You always do. But you never tell them how much you saved for them. You tell them you saved the item. You know, I restored it. Here's how much I charge you for it. But you never told them how much you saved them by restoring instead of replacing. And that's the beginning. Now, you put that little sheet with your other sheets, hand it into him, and he'll look at it, and he'll kind of raise an eyebrow, probably snicker at it, because he thinks, oh, it's another contractor trick. And he'll pass it on to his boss. He has to pass it on to his boss. His boss looks at it, and his boss does the same thing, kind of snickers and says, yeah, yeah, cute trick. And then you do it a second time for him. And he does the same thing. He looks at it, and he kind of, yeah, okay, I get it. It's that same contractor thing they did last time. And his boss looks at it and says, yeah, I see what they're doing, but, you know, they've been doing that all along. Third one, maybe the fourth. Anyway, he'll finally call. By the way, the one thing that adjusters never want to get is they call it the call. The call is when their boss calls them up and says, Harry, those contractors took you to the cleaners. I don't know what you were thinking, but you allowed all kinds of stuff that we would never, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. He doesn't want that call, because it means no promotion for you, no raise for you. And what do they want? They want their boss's approval in order to get raises and promotions and the trip to Hawaii and that sort of thing. So now what do you say to them? You say, okay, what I'm going to do for you is we're going to send those sheets in. Your boss is finally going to get to the point where he calls you. He's not going to call you for anything negative. He's going to call you up and say, Charlie, is that real? I've seen these yellow sheets you've been sending in. By the way, it doesn't have a yellow, but I was thinking of a yellow line sheet with real, you know, handwritten things. It doesn't have to be that way. It can be another sheet on the back, but make sure it's an extra sheet that shows how much you saved them. They take a look at it, and they say, and finally the third, fourth time, he says, is this real? And Charlie says, yeah, they actually do save that kind of stuff, but they've been doing that all along. He said, okay. Tell you what, see if you can get these guys a little more work. I'd like to see them do this again. You get the idea. It doesn't take long for them to figure out these guys are saving us money. Oh, and by the way, I talked to Kent Riddle. By the way, the agent trick I just talked about a minute ago, Kent Riddle is a contractor out of Tennessee, and he was the one who invented that one, the one with the business cards. He came up with that, and he's a genius. But one day, if you get a chance, give him a call. He's in. If you want his number, I'll get it for you. But he's a clever, clever fellow. This one is for adjusters, and the adjuster technology I just shared with you will get them interested, very interested, in giving you more work. But we're not done yet. During the job, train your staff to catch the adjuster doing something right. Now, I know that sounds difficult because your relationships are a little strained with adjusters anyway. But let's say an adjuster shows up and does his measurements and writes his estimate and so forth. And then he sticks around to sort of glower at your contents team. He goes over and looks over their shoulder and sees what they're doing, follows you through during your digital photo inventory, walks from room to room with you, kind of nodding distastefully. And you remember that. Take that information, carry it to the homeowner, and you say, Mrs. Wiedermeyer, I think you've got a great adjuster on this job. A lot of times adjusters don't even show up. They do it by computer. They phone it in. And this guy, first of all, he showed up, did his measurements. They're all genuine and real. And then he stuck around to watch our team. And I think he was making sure that we were doing a good job for you. And that's rare. That's extraordinarily rare in this industry. Just so you know, I think he actually cares about what's going on for your restoration. So, and then that's planting the seed. Now, at the end of the job, you walk through and you say, do you like what we did here? Do you like what we did there? And she's saying, oh, yeah, this is great. And you say, well, would you mind writing it down? I mean, we love testimonials. They're worth platinum to us. If you'll write us a testimonial based on what you just said, just say the same thing on a piece of paper, I would really appreciate it. And so she says, sure, I said I'd do it. And while she's writing, you say, by the way, do you think you'll renew your policy? This is important. Do you think you'll renew your policy with this company? And she says, well, yeah, I just told you, you did a good job. Yeah, if they do this, if they get guys like you working for me, sure, I'll renew with them when the time comes. Terrific. Well, you know, nobody says anything nice about adjusters ever, you say to her. And this one, yours, was really very, very good. If you could just write one sentence, like, I'm renewing my policy with you guys when the time comes. And I really liked what the adjuster did. So you put the two concepts together. I really liked your adjuster, and because of him, I'm going to renew my policy. Something of that nature. If you do that, that would make his day. So she does. Okay. Then we finish up with our testimonies. Oh, and by the way, if you want a really good testimonial, give him a sheet of paper. Have some testimonials already on there from other people, from other jobs you've done. Just figure a line sheet of paper, and you've got some testimonials already written there that are really good ones that you liked. That'll give her an idea of the kind of thing you're hoping for, and then she can write something of similar nature down on her part of the paper. Okay, now the bottom line, what you've just done is you gave him a testimonial. You got the adjusters don't get testimonials. That goes to his boss. His boss takes a look at it, and the boss says, Charlie, what's this about? Why is she giving you a testimonial? Nobody gets those. And he says, well, I think it's that same company that was doing those strange sheets on the back there that was saving us money. I think they were just trying to get in good with me. So they gave me a testimonial. And he said, well, that's great. And you say to Charlie, before he talks to the upper guy, his boss, you say, Charlie, look, you've got snipers out there that are writing terrible things about your company. You know that. But if we take testimonials like this and put them all around that, like if they named you on a job and they say, I really hate Charlie, he ripped me off from this such and such a company. If you go in there and they say, because of Charlie, I'm renewing my policy. See, suddenly we start surrounding these negative comments with positive ones. That's all that's really about. Okay, when I come back in a few minutes here, after Jen has shared some things with you, I'm going to show you how content solution fits in with all of this. It's the linchpin that holds all this stuff together. And having said that, Jen, are you with us?
I am. And we're ready to talk about where to get the cheapest printing. The cheapest printing we found is at Best Value Copy. It's an online service. It's very easy. It's cheap. And I'm going to share some of the specs with you. Don't think you have to try and remember all of the specs. I'm going to send it in a document to everybody. So I'm just going to review it real quick here so you can see. For 100 copies, we'll just use that as an example, you would have two pages. And if you go to the next slide, you would select color printing, double-sided. And it's an 11 by 17. So if you can see this is the 11 by 17 altogether. And it would be on a 32 pound glossy paper, which is a good thickness for mailing. So you can get it thicker if you want, if you're just gonna hand them out, but if you wanna mail them, that's the best one. The next slide. We're going to have it not collated, and that way you can get the half fold. The half fold will get this size for handing out. If you want to have them mailed, you can get an extra fold that's called the right angle fold with a wafer seal. So then it comes to you already ready to be mailed. All you need to put on it is the mailing label and a postage stamp and pop it in the mail. So there's no stapling or drilling required, so you can skip that section. But it comes out to anywhere between 60 cents to 90 cents per newsletter. And that's including the shipping cost and all of the finishing costs. So it's very reasonable.
How many do you have to order to get that price?
We've ordered as few as 20, and they come out to like, 22 cents a piece plus the finishing, plus the shipping. It's all usually around 50 to 60 cents. So it's pretty good. I'm going to share my screen now. We're going to talk about a little bit about how to do an email template. Because I know for the email version, a lot of you are doing a mass email. And not everybody has Constant Contact. You don't necessarily have to have it or MailChimp or any of those services. But I'm going to show you first how to do a template in Constant Contact. And then I'll show you how to do it in a regular email. What I love here with this, do that. You can go right over here to Create under Campaign and choose Email. And Constant Contact has templates already set up. They have dozens of these templates. So this will give you a really good idea. You can springboard off of one of these. Or it could give you just some good ideas on how to set up the layout, how to choose colors, and all of that. But I'm going to show you a real easy one with just the blank template here. Just select that. And we start with like the layout over here. You pick which kind of layout you want, which I usually pick this one, with a little picture, and I'll add an image, and I'll just drag the image to the top, because this is where I'll put my logo. I'll just insert that, and you can make that however big you want. And over here, I put a picture of the cover, which I usually take a screenshot. I already have one here. If you don't, and well, most people know how to take a screenshot. I use this little app called Snipping Tool. It's great because you can just do something real simple like this. And then you can just save it as a PNG or a JPEG or whatever you want to do. So put that there. And then over here, create your heading. Special Mold Edition. Here you put a little description with something catchy, something like an interesting question or something that would catch their interest and make them want to open and read the article. Here you can link this to your actual document. So if you go here where it says this drop-down box, you choose document. And you can upload from your computer our PDF. It'll give you the option here, browse from your computer, which I've already done. So here it is in my library, Content Solutions, and insert it. And I'll change my, here, I want to change my language on that too. I don't want it to say test link. I'll say read more. There we go. And just save it. So now when you preview it, and you click read more, you can test your link. And there's your PDF. So this is what they could open in their email. Now what Constant Contact has done here, if you notice at the top, Constant Contact has created a URL. They've created a shareable link. So anyone you send this link to can open up your PDF and read your newsletter. This is similar to what they do with Dropbox or Google Drive. So even if you don't have Constant Contact, you can still use this same method in your regular email. So here I'm going to show you. In my Outlook, I just open up a regular email. And let me go back to my image. If you just paste the image here, and say I open this in Google Drive, you know, and I have a share link, you know, you just copy this. And then when you go to your email and right click on your image, it has an option here for hyperlink. And you just paste that right there. So now anyone I send this email to will just be able to click on this picture and open up the newsletter in a PDF. So that's how you can do it as well. So if you want more tips, if you do have Constant Contact, they have a lot of great tutorials on how to do this and how to create, you know, beautiful emails that are very marketable. They'll give you pointers here, how to add your social media, how to add links to your website, like always link your logo to your website. So there's lots of other good things in there that I recommend you try that out. And then, you know, you'll get better at it as you go, but it's very intuitive and very easy to use. So were there any questions? Have any? If not, I will stop share.
Okay, before we go, before you go, Jen, can you mentioned Google Drive and one other one? What was the other one? Outlook? What
was it? Dropbox. Anywhere you could store your PDF on a cloud-based storage, they usually have a way that you can share the file with other people, just that file.
Okay. Now, but you say store the PDF. Is that an easy thing to do? I've never done it. So will they understand?
Yeah. I mean, you saw how Constant Contact does it. You know, it just uploads it and then it creates the link for you. So you don't have to do anything more than what it, you know, what we did here. It was pretty simple.
Great. So by putting a link in your email, any email, you can use the picture of the newsletter. Constant Contact.
Nice to use the picture as sort of a button. So then they just click on it.
And I suppose you can also put click here somewhere else.
Exactly. You can also add a hyperlink to any kind of text and do the same thing.
Outstanding. Well, thank you very much. And by the way, she's not kidding. She's another one of the bonuses you get by getting Content Solutions. You have Barb, you have me, you have her, and Tim Jackson, who's the invisible member of our team. But Tim is a master of machines. So if you're going to get a new ultrasonics machine or a washing machine or have a layout, Tim would be a very good man to talk to. So we have an entire team standing by to make you successful this year. And it's all free. Keep it short. We'll get in there, ask a question, and we'll answer your question for you. We'll make sure that you get what you need. Thank you, Jen. Can we go back to the PowerPoint? Is Barb with us? Okay. By the way, the reason I'm not doing my own PowerPoint is part of that glitch. The entire computer system just crashed. Now, we're talking about getting your list bigger. You need some more people on your list for adjusters and agents, especially. We can talk about all the others, you know, hospitals and government buildings. There are dozens and dozens of places you can go to increase your list. But let's talk about adjusters and agents, because I know that's ones that are very of great importance to you. To increase your list, first of all, like I said before, go find the ones who like you already. Find an adjuster who likes you. And talk to that adjuster. Go in there and say, Sam, I like working with you, and I think you like working with me. Now, remember, these guys have already said, we like you. Let's work together again. You say, I'm glad to hear you say that. I'm glad you feel that way. I want to work with some more adjusters like you. That's how I increase my business. So can you introduce me to some of your coworkers, other adjusters who are similar to you in their mindset and who would trust me in a similar way? Now, I earned your trust. And they don't know me. So I need an introduction. Can you do that for me? And he may say, well, there's Harry. He's about three doors down from me in the building here. And he's a good guy. I like him. Terrific. Could we walk down there and meet him right now? And he says, no, I'm not going to do that. Well, how about just give him a call from your phone maybe? No, I'm not going to do that for you either. Okay. Is there any way you could introduce me to the guy down the hall, three doors down the hall in the not too distant future? Because I'd really like to talk to him now. I want to do the same things for him that I promised I would do for you. Would you consider that? And so we talk him into it, get him to introduce you to other adjusters. Agents are the same way. Sam, I've been using your business cards and I think we're doing a pretty good job here. By the way, both these adjusters and agents will forget the great offer you made them. And the reason they're going to forget is because nothing's going to happen for a while. That is, let's say the agents. You go and get the lady to agree she's going to renew her policy and all that, and it looks good. And she even writes a little note to him, and he's feeling good about it. But, you know, her policy may not be renewable for 8 months. So that just sits there for 8 months waiting for something to occur. So you have to, that's where Contentz Solutions comes in. You're going to send Contentz Solutions to both agents and adjusters. Send it to them all the time, you know, every month. Send it to them. Get in their hands. Because what's going to happen is that's going to tell them more and more about what you can do. It'll remind them of what you did for them already. And some of the stories that the two techniques were based on were in those newsletters already. All right, but let's say you're saying, I don't really want to do that. I want to do something a little easier. Can I just buy a list? And the answer is yes. There are lists out there that you can buy. I don't want to say them on the air because email me privately and I'll introduce you to them because I don't trust them. One of them, I think, said something like, we have every adjuster in America, and they offered me a list of just around 2,000 adjusters. Well, shoot, there's more adjusters than that in most states. So no, I know you're thinking that's not the case, but trust me, I checked it out recently on a statistical analysis. And you're going to find there's a whole lot more adjusters than you know, not because they're not just homeowners or home adjusters. They're also, injury adjusters and car adjusters and all, there are many other things. So just know that that list, I just don't trust it. I found two or three lists, and I'll share them with you if you want, but not on this program because I don't feel they're the best for you. I think going to the adjusters and the agents and asking them to help you get more agents and adjusters is aces. And by the way, there was an article in Clean Facts magazine not long ago by an adjuster, Peter Crosa. And Peter said, look, you guys don't know this, but you only need one adjuster. If you get one adjuster who really likes you and gives you all his business for a year, you're a $1 million career right there. And he's not kidding. If you add it up, you'll see one adjuster who actually feels good about you and will give you all his business or most of his business, you'll discover that you'll do very nicely. So I don't like the shotgun approach very much. I won't say don't do it. It's something you can certainly try. But the adjusters you don't know, but whose email addresses you have, sure, email them. And we're going to talk about how to do that right now. You'll see that it says claims pages there, and actually has a claims pages. That claims pages is an online newsletter for adjusters and agents and others. But 1 year, Tim Jackson was at a PLRB conference. And at that conference, he saw a book, and he opened it up, just sort of leafed through it. And what he saw was all the adjusters' addresses, their names, phone numbers, all over California, all of them. It was as big as a telephone book. He just was leafing through, and he's amazed. He said, where'd you guys get this? And they said, we compile it, and it's available through our magazine. So he called the magazine, Claims Pages. He said, I want to buy one of those books, because he was in the state of California at the time. And he said, do you have some for other states? And they said, yeah, about 30 states now. And he said, okay, I'd like to buy one. They said, no, get an ad with us. It's only $1,000 for an ad, and we'll give you the book for free. And he said, no, I just want to buy the book. And they said, well, yeah, but really what you want to do is get the ad, because the ad will really expose you well to the adjusters and agents, and you get the book free. And that went on for a while. And finally, Tim said, look, I just want the book. How much is it? And finally, they said, all right, it's $75. You can buy the book. So that is a legitimate list. It's real. You can, it'll work for you. But all the states don't have it yet. But Claims Pages for free will give you a handful of adjusters' names, addresses, and telephone numbers. And here's how we do it. First of all, take a look at the page we're looking at right now. You see the green arrow pointing down to the block providers. I clicked on providers when I went to their page. And Barb, would you go to the next page, please? This is what I saw. It offered me some categories of adjusters and adjusters, appraisers, attorneys, etc. And I clicked on adjusters. Pretend like you clicked on adjusters, Barb, and let's go to the next page. And you'll notice it says this is a page from Claims Pages, but you see Frontier Adjusters down in the lower left-hand corner. Actually, there's a list of about 20 more companies below that. But I just typed in the zip code for Pinellas County in Florida, and I said I want to try adjusters. And so they came up with this whole list of places to find adjusters, and one of them was Frontier. Didn't know anything about Frontier, but I clicked on it. Barb, would you click on it and take us to the next page? And this is what it, this is some more of what they look like. I could have clicked on the pilot catastrophe services down there at Churchill. I don't know anything about them, but okay, that's all right. Go ahead. Go to the next page, Barb. I know you want to. And this is when I clicked on frontier adjusters. This is the page that came up. It says find an adjuster in the middle there. See it? Find an adjuster. I typed in, instead of typing in a zip code this time, and I didn't want to do Florida again. I'd already done Florida. Let's try Alabama or something like that. Let's try just a city. And so I typed in a city. Let's go to the next page. Atlanta I got. Okay. And there it is, Atlanta. Now here's the interesting thing. Notice to the under the owner operator, there's Amanda and her email address, her phone number. There's Robert, and it goes on from there. And it goes on for a couple of pages. And these are all free. So you just got a free list of adjusters in your area, and they're all adjusters. And we don't know. It's a bit of a turkey or a crapshoot, as they say. It's not going to tell you what kind of adjuster they are. It doesn't tell you what they're going to do. But it's in claims pages. The odds are really good. It's going to have something to do with home because they don't care about cars. Claims pages is all about claims, of course. But mostly it's about homeowners and home insurance. Okay, let's go to the next page, please. Okay, now that you've started building your list, and by the way, there are lots of places to find lists like that. I found them for various agencies. You just start looking, but there are lots of other places to find them. But once we got the list, and by the way, again, off the air, if you want to talk to me, I'll help you find ways of locating more email addresses for adjusters and agents in your area. But the thing is, even once you've got that list, it's almost valueless unless you get a business formula going for it. This is an old one that I've got on the screen right now. Attention, interest, desire, action, AIDA. The AIDA formula is an oldie. It's probably invented back in the 50s or 60s. But it's a fairly solid one and trustworthy. It'll do what you want it to do. Next page, please. First, we want to get their attention. And this is an old issue of Content Solutions there on the right. You recognize the picture I showed you earlier. And it says, don't forget you save $38.71. Ever gone to Walmart and they hand you the receipt? And when they hand you a receipt, they circle it and they say, and you save $31.47 today on your purchases today. Well, you did the same thing. That's basically what this is all about. But this particular cover had a good message inside it, but I wasn't sure if they were going to understand what it meant. So I want to write a note to them. That is, when you put your email together in the subject line, or if you're handing it to them, put a little post-it note, tape it up in one of the corners there, and hand it to them. But write a note, and again, subject line for emails is best, and just put down something like, hi, Sue. We'll show your manager how you save massive sums for them. It's on page 2. There it is. She opens it up, looks at page 2, and there's the story we just shared with you a minute ago about we want to get your business cards and all that. We put that in there. And they also the one about we're going to make your adjuster famous with his boss. We started writing stories about that a while back, and we repeat them from time to time. So it's not uncommon for you to find, if you haven't got one already, you'll find one of that nature. We never repeat the same story. We repeat the same concept from time to time, though, and I think you won't be disappointed if you get a hold of that. Let's go to the next page, please. This is a story on the inside of the newsletter, and a subject line I would have written would say something like, hello, Sam, we are helping agents get renewals, no charge. Now, Sam's going to think, well, I want some renewals two and no charge. That gets my attention. So now he'll open it up and have a look at the story, and the story will do the rest for you. It gets their desire going. It gets their interest going. Let's go to the next page, please. Okay, this is another cover. And the subject line would have been, hey, Bob, did you hear about the $5,000 Coco Chanel purse restored for $79.99? Now, agents or adjusters, either one are going to like this idea a lot. If an agent has a client who has leather purses and furs and that sort of thing, and you're the only person who brought it to his attention that you restore furs and you restore leather, and really that's all you need to get his attention, and then you start building his interest and with the story on the inside. But you have to have a captivating subject line to make it work. Are you thinking of a better one than this? I hope you are. I mean, this is not a bad subject line that's on there right now, but you can do better. What you're trying to do is say, what would really startle this guy, wake him up, and make him want to open my newsletter? Next page, please. This is somebody who did it. This is Dolworth. They're in the Dallas-Fort Worth area. And actually, I should say thank you, Amanda. Amanda's one of their co-workers, and she actually puts this together. And take a look at the paragraph there. Dear agents and adjusters, this month's edition of Content Solutions explain how we can save you money by restoring, not replacing. As you know, fire and water damage can be tricky tragedies. And then it has a quote from the inside of the newsletter, which is a very cool idea. Contents teams don't cost money. They save on virtually every job. They seek strategies and tactics that make things easier for the adjusters. They give the business owners or homeowners reasons to want to renew their policies instead of writing angry letters to the home office and state agencies. That builds the interest of the adjuster. He's saying, you know, that sounds good to me. This is the kind of stuff I would like to be reading instead of those stupid sales letters I get all the time. And by the way, the only reason they throw these content solutions away is because they think they're a sales letter. And the only reason they think that is because somebody presented it to them wrong. If you hand it to them and say, this is not a sales letter. This is pieces of information that are going to help you get promotions, get raises. This newsletter is filled with ideas that you can share at meetings with your coworkers. That kind of stuff. What it does is get them interested in having a look. They'll glance through it. They may not read the whole thing. Nobody does. But the headlines inside should get their attention. Let's go to the next slide, please. Okay. The covers and the headlines get them interested too. If you look at the one on the left-hand side with all the flame and the smoke, contents professionals, hassle-free estimates. Do you see that one? Contents professionals, hassle-free estimates. Well, there's nobody giving the adjusters articles like these. Nobody but you. You're the only one in your entire territory that says, we'll give you hassle-free estimates. But no pushback. We don't fight you. We're going to show you a better way to go. And then you share Barb's secret with them, how we do estimates that are agreeable to you because you actually helped design them. And then down the lower left-hand corner, this is the latest one that just came out. I know you've seen it. But in the very center there, Contents pros help agents get policy renewals again. See, I told you we repeat the stories. That first one I showed you with the guy with the flowers over his face, you can see his face. That's an oldie. That must be maybe 4 or 5 years old. This one is your latest one, but this is different. See, we say that is agents like us, not just because we get them their policies renewed and not just because of the card trick. Basically, they like us because we save their clients stuff. We sit down and somebody calls up and says, I've got this collection of fine wines, Charlie, and I've got my policy with you guys, but I need somebody who's better than the average guy who's going to save my wines because they're worth a fortune. If somebody scuffs a label, it's worth half what it was before. If they put it in the sunlight out there in the driveway and it gets hot, it ruins the vintage. We can't sell it, so I lose money. But you've already told them that as you've written, we sent you 3 or 4 articles about that kind of stuff to the agent. So the agent says, the only company I know that can do that for you, Bob, is this one. And then they send you over instead of anybody else. They can't think of anybody else. So these headlines and the covers usually do the job for you. Now, look at the font, one on the far right-hand side. It has the headlines aren't all that powerful this time. Water damage, of course, they're always interested in that. Wet furniture, of course, it's an interesting thing, but it doesn't have, where's the benefit for them? That's what they're wondering. Where's the benefit? Why would I read this newsletter? Well, that's your job. You put a little post-it note on the outside if you're handing it to them, a little post-it note. Inside this, we show 3 different ways we can save you money on virtually every water damage job. Think about that. In this issue, we show you 3 different ways we can save you money on virtually every water damage job. Something like that. That should get them to really want to read the newsletter at that point. Okay, let's go to the next one. Now, okay, I would love to blow this up and make it larger, but there isn't time for that. So take a look at where the arrows are. See the blue arrows? There's a line there that says, they can make a presentation to the adjuster that is short, concise, and all-inclusive. Well, there's no adjuster alive who wouldn't like to hear that. They can make a presentation to the adjuster that's short, concise, and usually all-inclusive. And there's more stuff around it, of course. There's all manner of things in that article. But that sort of thing builds their desire because they're saying, I want that. I want to have a short, concise, usually all-inclusive type of estimate. I've not seen one of those ever And that's where pushback comes from. When they don't understand what your estimate's all about, they'll push back. They'll say, I'm not buying this. And if you wait to the end, instead of using Barb's technique, you wait to the end and hand it to them, which is a lot of contractors doing that now. They get trapped. They get locked in. They play, let's make a deal with the agents and adjusters. And that won't work for you. You know, you're already losing money because every time they start making a deal with you, you know they're going to cut the money down. It's going to go smaller. If you make the deal before you begin, you say, this is what we will do. This is how much we're going to charge. And they say, well, we're not going to pay for that, but we'll pay this. We lock that in. We say, okay, we are now both agreed that you're going to pay me that amount of money for doing this job in this way. And you do the job in that way and you get paid. It's as simple as that. Look at the next paragraph down with the big arrow. The job is done on time, on budget, and with a customer who felt the contents manager was a valued ally. That way, the adjuster gets another job off his or her desk. His boss is satisfied, the insured is happy, and the contractor is paid in a timely manner. That's a dream job for an adjuster. He wants that because you did two things there. You took the burden off his shoulders having to deal with the owner. Owner felt that the contents people were doing a good job and working with him or her. And then the adjuster got all the benefits from it. That's what you're telling in that article. Okay, next one, please. Back one page, please. There you go. Okay, this is, I know that looks very different from what you're yours. This is Marty Bachman. And he's what he did was he used every available inch of space for, you'll notice in the upper left-hand corner, that entire block. He decided, I'm not going to mail these out. I'm going to only hand them out when I go to see adjusters and agents, and I'll worry about mails later. I'll put the other one in the email. But he said, I want every possible inch used, and so he did. The entire upper block is filled in. And by the way, you can do that too. If that becomes important to you, it's certainly available. And he decided he wanted the IICRC certified logo in there and the BBB. He put everything he possibly could in the every available space. And I just wanted you to see what a fancy one would look like. Okay, take a look at the next page. And this is a simpler one. This is one we use. This is Barb's, Total Contentz. And you'll notice there's a big white space. And you know, all of you know the white space is for a return address in the lower middle there. A recipient address. And the upper left-hand corner is a stamp. Upper right-hand corner, forgive me. Make the arrow go to the right now. That's good. Now go up because we're going to show where the stamp goes. Okay, stamp goes there. Again, I'm sorry, guys. I don't have access to the PowerPoint, and so Barb is pedaling as fast as she can to keep up. But this is what a regular most of them look like. Most of the ones we've done. And yeah, Barb's pointing to the back cover, and she was showing us the block there with that she has an idea for that back block. But I just wanted you to see the difference. Many of you look like ours. Some of them look like Marty's, and it's entirely up to you as to which way you want to go. We have no problem with adding in those extra pieces that like Marty liked. But here's the thing: if you're going to give us chunks of art to go in there, make sure they're the right size to fit. If you make them too small or you make them a jagged size, it'll make it very difficult for us to fit in that space. If you give us something that actually is the proper dimensions of that back cover, we'll be delighted to put in some extra pieces for you if you want to. Okay, Barb, we're almost done. Let's go to the next piece. Okay, there are lots of places to find more contacts and get more email addresses and more addresses in general. PLRB is one of the best places. Those are conferences where adjusters go. There's one that's not on the list called Blue Goose. Blue Goose is not nearly as popular as it once was, but it used to be an adjusters club. They only allowed adjusters and agents in, insurance people. That was the only ones that got in. But later they opened the doors to contractors. And a lot of contractors joined up. Why? Because it's a room full of adjusters. And they have meetings, sort of like Rotary Club or Lions Club, but for adjusters. And they have lectures, they share information, and you meet lots of contacts there. And they have conferences. And that's where, remember I told you Tim found that book? It was at a PLRB conference that he found that book with all the adjusters for the whole state in it. And the building owners, you know that's a club. Barb knows more about that one, and be sure to ask her if you want to know more about it. Business networks, of course, Chamber of Commerce. Chamber of Commerce will have lists of service clubs, Rotaries, Lions, Kiwanis, that sort of thing. They're usually outdated, but by all means, I know it's hundreds. I don't know how many hundreds it was. It was several hundred Rotaries, Lions, and Kiwanis clubs. You look at the bottom there. By the way, women's business groups, before I go to the next one, I should tell you, women's business groups is how there was a very famous guy in the field, Phil McLaughlin, And Phil got involved with an insurance woman's business group out on Long Island. And they asked him to be their Santa Claus one year. From that year on, his business was assured. He went out and did Santa ho, ho, ho. I'll tell you the short version. They put him in a really cheap Santa costume, and it was a cardboard belt, and the belt broke, and his pants fell down. And he said the women went bananas. They invited him back. He was a Santa Claus for several years thereafter. But more importantly, every time he walked into one of their offices, the women would come out and say, woohoo, and all the guys come out to see what the racket was about. And he got to know all the adjusters and agents in those offices because of that one meeting. Just keep it in mind, it's not going to happen for you every time that way, but know that there are business groups out there that many of them have insurance adjusters and agents in them, and many of those are, and there are ones who are just for females. The service clubs, Rotary Alliance, Humanists, they always want a lecture. They're always hungry for lectures. You make a funny one. Put a funny one together about your business, about your company, what you can do for them. Tell a couple of horror stories, toss them in. You only have 20 minutes. But in 20 minutes, you can cram a lot of information about who you are, what you can do for them. And if there's not an adjuster in the group, there's going to be a whole lot of business companies. In Rotary clubs, to get in, you have to either be the owner of a company or in the highest echelon of the administration of a company. The others don't require that, but they still have them. They have business guy leaders in those groups. But to get into Rotary, you have to either own a company or be the head of administration. Okay, let's take a look at the next one, Barb. Okay. Barb would like to replace. She was showing you a minute ago. Remember where it says on all of your issues, it says coming up in the next issues of Content Solutions, here are three things to look at. The three different stories are going to be in there in the future. Well, she wants to replace that. She's been thinking about it for a long time, and I fought her on it every time she brings it up. She has different ideas of how to replace it. She says, why don't we just give them more advertising space? Barb, can you go back a couple of pages? Go back to the one with Marty.
Okay, yeah.
And by the way, Barb, you get to cut, since I'm saying horrible things at this point, you get to cut in and say, I didn't see that. I never did that. You get to.
Oh, I'm just having a good time listening. That's
okay.
Good.
And by the way, kids, I know we're almost out of time. I mean, we're out of time. And I just want to, I want to address this. Barb wants to replace. Barb, would you show them the area you'd like to replace there?
This here, the coming up in the next issues of the Content Solutions.
I'm sorry, my fear. And Barb, I by the way, Barb's the boss, and she can fire me at any time. So I know I'm playing with dynamite here, but I just want to say my feeling on this. If we took Marty's upper half of the thing, of the back cover, and put it down there at the below, and had two of those, I'm not saying identical, but you know, same kind of information at the bottom, it begins to look very much like a sales letter, and that scares me, because we don't want the adjusters and agents, or anybody, the hospital administrators, the county officials, we don't want anybody seeing this as a sales letter. Of course it is one. We know that. And of course we have advertising all over it. But the thing is, if they start to think of it as that, it will end up in the trash can along with the other sales letters. And that's my major fear. But Barb had another idea. What would you like to do other than that, in that same slot?
Well, my thought was it could be used as an area where we have a did you know section. So what is a soot sponge made of? And, you know, A, B, or C. And then we could have the answer hidden somewhere, or, you know, like upside down in that same little block. So it would be more of like an informational type of spot. Another idea, did you know that whether a moving company loses an iPhone or a can of soda, they only compensate the client 69 cents per pound? So it would be more of like a did you know or fun facts. So just give us your input. You know, which one do you prefer? If you have any other ideas of, you know, for using that space right there, because in reality, these are not truly articles that are upcoming. Steven's using it as a teaser, you know, so they look forward to the next issue. And like he says, that we're not using the entire back cover just for advertising space. So just give us your thoughts.
Well, these are upcoming articles. The ones that are listed, they are upcoming, but they're not in the next issue. And people say, well, why not just put the ones that are in the next issue? And that would make it more poignant. What I've been doing is choosing topics that I hear are important. And thus, you know, I'm not going to bore you with this. Just know that these aren't pretend. They are pretend for the next issue, but we always have those coming up in the next issues. They're fire stories, water stories, damage stories of various statures. Mm-hmm. Barb, go back to the page where you're going to show them the club cards, the the presents, the gifts. Yeah. Whoops.
Did I pass it? Oh. Yes. Oh, okay. Here you go.
The prizes. Now, when Barb first suggested putting up, you know, the Did You Know or a contest of some kind, I said, look, why don't we make it, get, you know, give them a gift of some kind if they get it right. Call us with the right answer and you get a free thing. Now, Barb chose email us with the correct answer and we will come to your office with a $20 Starbucks gift card or a $20 Visa card, that kind of thing. And again, I know my career is going to be real short. She took out, I wrote some other stuff. And she
Go ahead. Tell them.
She took it all. I said, email us or give us a call and we'll bring to your office 20 tacos from Taco Bell. For me, I bring a mariachi band along with it. And play. everything I do is bombastic. I do it larger than life because I want them to not miss. I want to go to the office and have every adjuster, every agent, everybody who's in that office looking at us and saying, what the heck? And then we say, Señor, 20 tacos from Taco Bell. And they all are saying, well, what the heck? How do you get that? And thus it becomes a topic of conversation in the office. Now, again, the mariachi band is probably over the top, but if they see us walking in, making a big deal out of 20 tacos, or I said, or two large pizzas, any toppings you want, from
Pizza Hut.
Well, yeah, Pizza Hut. Pick a restaurant you like. And then you get to choose the toppings. We tell them. All right. Now, again, that's not because if you do it the way Barb is suggesting, $20 gift card, you walk in and say, Charlie, here's a gift card. Congratulations. You got the prize. Okay. And by the way, a lot of you thinking, gee, what if a whole bunch of them call me? And you know, so here's $20 worth of pizza here and $20 worth of pizza there and 20 tacos, that's going to really put a dent in the old budget. Have you any idea the kind of publicity you just got? There's six ways to persuade somebody, and one of them is the giving of a gift. As soon as you give a gift to somebody, they immediately want to give something back. What do they got to give you? A job. How many $20 is that worth you? And please forgive me if I'm going over the top here. I know this works. I've seen it work. And by the way, down below it says Kent Riddle took the adjusters shooting. Kent is that genius from Tennessee I was telling you about. Kent got the bunch of young adjusters and got some high-powered rifles. He had AKs, AK-47s, SKs, high-powered shotguns, and large bottles of water. Took them out to the – this is in Tennessee, so you understand it's not the same kind of present for everybody. But in Tennessee, to take a bunch of young bucks out there with high-powered weapons, he said they were like Rambos. They're blowing away the water bottles and having a blast. Not one of those guys can forget Kent Riddle. And by the way, this is the grand finale for me. People are in, Kent told me, and he was the first to tell me, other guys have told me since, but people are, the adjusters are bypassing their own vendor list to get Kent's company to work for them. And I said, Kent, how are they doing this? Couldn't be the shooting thing. He said, no, that's part of the package. He said, what's really making it work is that I showed them that we are different from every other company, and we can do things for them no other company can. And because the adjuster has to justify his choice to his boss, that's imperative. So what happens is the adjuster says, his boss calls him up and said, why did you bypass the vendor list and hire this company? He said, because boss, I called up six other companies and said, do you handle damaged art? Every last one of them said, no. And Kent's company said, yes, we have a guy up and he told about to the company he uses. And he said, what I do is I'll take a picture of the painting. I will send that photograph to the company. They will take a look at it and talk about how much it will cost to restore that kind of art. Even tell us how much the art is worth because they're professionals. It's a conservancy company. He does that kind of stuff. And he said, that's a company we really want. Another guy says, do you handle fine wines? And several companies said yes. And then they ask him a key question. At what temperature will you store them? And everybody said, refrigerator. We'll put them in the refrigerator. It'll be good. Well, anybody who's a fine wine collector knows you put a bottle of wine in the refrigerator. Refrigerator cycles, and so you turn wine into vinegar that way. Real collector would do that. But you know the answer because in various issues of Content Solutions, we've written stories like that, and it's 52 degrees, is give or take a few degrees, and they build a special cabinet. That's what we do. We take plastic and 2x4s and build a special containment center for them. We do not turn the bottles up on end. We keep them flat He says we also pack them so that none of the labels get scraped. He tells that kind of stuff, the kind of stuff you know from our editions, and the kind of stuff the agents have known because they've seen those editions, they've read them, and thus you become a hero and the only choice for that adjuster. He can't choose somebody who's going to mess up the job. He's going to choose somebody who'll do it right, and that's you because of what you told him you could do in the newsletter. Okay, is there anything else we've left out, Barb?
No, I think that's it. If anybody has any comments or questions, feel free to write those in. If you have a specific question, you write it in right now, we can address it now. Otherwise, you know, you're welcome to email or call any of us.
That's all part of the package. And she's not kidding. You can get her for 30 minutes for free. You can get me for an hour for free. I'm cheaper. And the other thing is Jen and Tim are standing by with technical type questions and they'll help you. But no kidding, if any of this stuff went over your head or you felt, gee, Steve moved awful fast with that stuff, and of course I did. If you want to talk it over, make an appointment with me. It's first come, first serve, because I know it's going to be a bunch of you. But when you want it, we'll both find a time that's okay for both of us and bring in your sales staff, and I'll sit down and talk with them. Probably not this way. We'll just get on the phone and we'll talk, put me on speakerphone, and let them ask questions, and we'll make it easy. But I'll answer the questions as best I can.
Yeah, and one other thing that we'd like to stress too is to build excitement for your team, your marketing team. Let them know, you know, like what's in the articles. Think about who else can distribute the newsletter for you. So make sure that your contents manager has a stack of the printed newsletters that they can take with them as they're meeting with homeowners and other people. They're actually one of your best salespeople for the contents division because their heart is in it. And so as many times as they can share it is great. With your structure estimators, anybody at all who's meeting anybody, any adjusters, please, you know, educate them on the newsletter, the value of it. Any of them that you can actually take out to a pack out, let your marketing person walk the pack out and let them see all the challenges that your team is dealing with on a daily basis. Let them go into the contents division at your warehouse and, you know, maybe even let them work a day or so out in the field or in the contents warehouse that they're familiar with contents restoration, and, you know, build the pride and so that they can speak openly and help to market your division too. So if you want any more pointers like that, you know, feel free to get in contact with us as well. So, Steven, anything else that you'd like to share?
I just want to thank you guys for hanging with us for an extra 15
minutes. Absolutely.
The glitches were ours, and we want to applaud you for hanging in there. Thank you.
Okay. Well, we are going to have a recording. We will send you a link so that you can share this with other members of your marketing team, and we'll also send you the information more specifically about the how to get your printing done. We have offered the service. We've actually had your issues printed. We put the stamps on them and actually mail them. We've offered the service of sending out the mass emails from our constant contact service, and it does look like it's coming directly from your email. So if you happen to be interested in that as well, just talk to Jen. But thank you so much for joining us, and we appreciate your patience, and you'll be receiving an email from Jen later today. So thanks, everybody.
Thank you, everyone.
Bye-bye.